Okay, and we're coming back. Feel like I missed a step here. Like I jumped from this sort of like thing to them introducing themselves. And I agree with you about the more aggression.
Yeah, this guy seems like if he saw something he couldn't immediately identify, his sword's gonna come out immediately.
Yeah. You think, Troy? I think
that's what it always feels like.
Yeah, I think that's how it always feels like, and Logan agrees. It just how it is.
Maybe this is the best way to create time travel. It's just edit. If the more intensely you edit, the further back in time you'll go. Time will slow down so much it just reverses.
Think about it this way, Droney. Those thumbnails you were working on, these are my thumbnails. So now I'm using all that feedback that people gave me and mostly I gave myself, and now I'm actually making real things out of it. Well, sure, but it's knowing when something is good enough. That's kind of the skill, right? I don't know, Johnny. I think you should just kind of let that llama sit as it is and work on another one. Maybe a llama tank. No, I'm not Jonah. Yeah. So, I guess my next question is, Sam. It's very, well, I don't know if it's a question, I guess. It's a comment that will spark discussion, I hope. But how do you deal with that sense of being the author and knowing everything? Where you're writing a scene and you're moving along and suddenly a character is a little bit off, like they know something's going to happen. Like in that way where actors react a little bit too quick, or they react a little bit too oddly because they know something is going to happen to them despite how hard they're trying to act like they don't.
Do you know everything that happens in your story? Holy crap, I totally don't.
This story, yes, pretty much.
Well, you gotta kind of distance yourself from it a little bit, I feel like. I try and let my characters explore things themselves a lot, and then, you know, let that define them rather than me trying to know everything that they are. Like, they inform me more than I inform them, I think.
Yeah, I've heard that opinion discussed a lot, and sort of that let the characters do their thing and you're just along for the ride and not knowing and all that stuff. And I'm not against that. I'm noticing little bits in here where I've done that. Like this moment here where he's kind of like, I was supposed to do this. Like, he's already relinquished his goal, but he hasn't been convinced to relinquish his goal. He's just kind of done it. That being said, I was kind of going... I was kind of going for this thing where we don't know if the siren brainwashed him or not. But I don't think that communicates very well right now, as of right now.
No. But that's tough, because, I mean, that's... You're getting into unreliable narrator territory.
Gardener versus architect. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Because I totally take the architect route. I am a master planner.
I think the best way, or the best possible way, is probably somewhere in between there. But yeah, it's very much depends on your preference there and on your personal style.
Yeah, well, we've already established that I'm way too much of a micromanager when it comes to this stuff, probably.
Well, as long as it comes out to something, you know, usable.
I think it comes also from knowing a lot more about... knowing a lot more about my plot and my structure and my idea than about the characters themselves. Which I guess in and of itself is a problem.
Maybe, but in a different light, that could be extremely good because you have created the environment through which you're going to pass these characters, and then they can react naturally to that.
Yeah. Though I suppose the opposite is also true. Where
absolutely.
The characters are too controlled because I don't allow them to act naturally, I just react them how I think they should react.
Yeah, you're reacting like you're puppeteering these people and you need to make them dance, but you don't necessarily have to do that. Like, if you prod them, they're going to react on their own. And if they don't, it's going to feel really unnatural, and so you're going to have to change that to make them react in a natural way anyway. So it kind of, it's self-sustaining, almost.
Well, almost self-defeating, really.
Sort of.
Well, I guess the way I look at it is, if you've spent all this effort making them do the thing you want, and then when you edit, knowing that you'll have to change them because they're not going to be good, you might as well have just done them good in the first place.
Well, but that's the whole point. You're iterating. You didn't know that before. Writing the first draft was what informed you of that new information.
Yeah. Yeah, and I do that, Johnny. I do make character sheets. I don't do it as much as I probably should. But my problem with character sheets is, as much as I know how important every detail on those sheets are, I don't care about certain things. And I mean, maybe that's my fundamental problem of, I need to care about the details I don't think matter in order to inform my characters better. But also, maybe I just need to adopt a better character style that more suits what I want to do while giving me enough information to have those things that will inform the character. I know. What do you think about that, Sam?
Sorry, what? I was looking away for a second.
What kind of moderator? I'm going to ban you.
Not a good moderator. Make a character sheet.
Yeah, I was saying how I don't like using character sheets as much as I probably should, because there's a lot of details on them that I don't care about. And I was saying that that might be a fundamental problem with me, but maybe I should figure out a way of doing a character sheet that will have the information I want, as well as information that I can use to inform the character without seeming annoying or boring or whatever. I guess maybe I'm just being a dreamer and that doesn't exist, but...
What if, I mean, the way I do it is almost the opposite way. I'll have the sheet and that's just like my record of what this character has done or said or thought, rather than it operating as the borders of what that character is. I'm like working from the inside out.
Yeah, I don't know if you've ever looked at it, but oh god, I'm gonna totally forget her name, as even though I love it so much. Holly. Give me a sec.
Yeah, I definitely feel like putting everything that you can think of in, and then kind of carving off the bits that don't need to be there. And even then, like, you know that that could have been a scene. It's just not one that's within the scope of the story you're telling right now.
Yeah. I mean, I'm literally doing that in this. I deleted more than half the scenes I originally planned because I decided that they weren't interesting to the story. But I used those scenes to inform the story of what was going on in the background that we don't necessarily see. So I'm thinking of Holly Lizzle? Lyle? Oh god, I can't pronounce this. Oh, never heard it pronounced. Anyway, she's a writer. She's written a ton of novels. No one's ever read her books. Except she's written a bunch of really, really awesome books on writing. Specifically fantasy writing and world building and that kind of stuff. And her idea is that you have a binder, and the binder is divided into specific sections of like culture, clothing, activities, whatever. And every time you add something to the story, you toss another page in the binder with that detail. Like a living record, so you can reference it later if you need to.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's just an extension of write down everything.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, like, she has a specific organizational pattern and describes it in great detail in her book. Interesting. What software do you use, Logan? Are you just like you just use like Microsoft Word or something, and then have like separate bio files? Or are you just using character.txt as an example? And I agree with that, and I probably need to do stuff like that more. I don't know. I was just thinking, I guess I'm too much of a planner. I need to know things. Because otherwise I get caught in these deep ruts of, like, not doing anything. That being said, there are people who plan a lot more than me. I feel like I'm somewhere in the middle ground of the spectrum, because I like having a clear idea, but not necessarily knowing every detail. There are some people, some authors, and I've read books by them, writing books by them, where they're like, "Yeah, no, we plan everything, down to the scene, characters, like," and I was like, "That sounds annoying." Difficult.
Yeah, they know like the brand of socks that their characters are wearing, stuff that you would never possibly ever encounter.
I found this awesome character profile thing that has 400 questions on it.
That seems like too many questions.
I don't even know what you could ask in 400 questions. Like, what would you even ask about?
You could ask everything. Like, what is their favorite piece of music? What is their favorite book? You're never discussed literature with these characters, and it's never going to come up, but knowing what their particular taste is could somehow, I guess, inform some decision, I guess.
I respect the hell out of that, Logan. I actually enjoy writing in Notepad a lot more than I thought I would. I've been using it a lot lately because the computers I have access to at work don't necessarily have any word processing software. For the few times I actually get to do things at work, which is not often. But I love Scrivener. I use Scrivener for everything. And Scrivener is awesome where it allows you to have that sort of character file off to the side and you can just throw things in there.
Yeah, worried about Scrivener is you can do that and have it write up at the same time.
Yeah.
In the same piece of software.
I figured out that you can lock Windows the other day, and it was like mind-blowingly awesome.
What do you mean you can lock Windows?
You can lock Windows so that they don't change. So you can have like your draft open and lock it, and then you can whatever you click on in the menu will only go to the second window.
Oh.
Which is super useful if you're doing a specific thing.
I'm locking something right now. What am I doing? What does this mean? It's all red. My God.
Yeah.
My God, what a brave new world of text editing this is.
Like, just discovering all those little bits.
What is this?
Yeah, you missed... You weren't there for pretty much most of the week because you were at work, but...
Yeah, I have to work for a living. Not all of us can just take... Whatever.
Yeah. If you can use the keywords, there's a keywords bar, and you can just put things in it, and you can literally, like, put characters' names in it and just drag them onto your page whenever you need them. Which is super awesome when you have crazy Greek spellings.
I see, yeah. So you only have to type it once.
Yeah. it's under Control-Shift-O.
No. Oh my God, yeah, and you can just dump it right in the text. That's bizarre.
Yeah.
Hmm. I don't know when exactly I'd use that myself, but I'm sure I will eventually.
It's come in handy quite a few times this week. Mostly because, like I said, crazy Greek spelling.
Oh, how did we meet? What a romantic story that is.
Do you want to tell the story? I'm cool if you tell the story.
I'm pretty sure the story is just we worked at the same place.
That's
got arbitrarily assigned to the same area and we worked together and that was it. It was just pure chance.
Yep. That's pretty much how it went.
Yeah, that's actually, that's even kind of an interesting character point. Not everything has to be by design.
Yeah.
Things just get smashed together a lot of the time in real life. But that that can be difficult from a narrative perspective, because as a reader, you want, and even as a writer, you want things to be there for a reason.
Yeah.
Having something that's just there and does nothing is distracting and sometimes frustrating. It's a Chekhov's gun kind of problem.
Yeah, exactly. I was discussing that yesterday as well. Where you have a lot of editorial control, and sometimes it's about flavor and sometimes it's not, but you don't, anything that's not necessary to what the story you're telling really shouldn't be there. That being said,
yeah, definitely...
your story doesn't necessarily have to have a the thing that I think you can take out of that is, even if something happens accidentally, if it matters to the story, then that's okay. We are we're pretty similar in terms of tastes in general.
Yeah, it's just a thing where people with similar interests kind of end up being funneled together.
Yep. Well, that's not where we met. We met over cheese.
What?
Huh?
What are you talking about, cheese?
You taught me how to stock cheese.
Oh yeah. That's true.
Yeah. We met like a long time ago, but we didn't become friends until more recently when we like actually spent a lot more time together.
Yeah. Well, I don't think work is not a great place to just like have a casual conversation about writing. So that you gotta kind of actively work to get to that point.
I think that's both true and not true. But yes. I've totally had conversations with Andrew Pratt about Russian literature casually on couches and breaks.
Yeah, that's true. Break's a little different. When you're like working with someone, like piling stuff up or trying to organize what it is you're doing, usually you're not, or at least I'm not, in that kind of academic mindset. I kind of switch gears.
Yeah, no, I totally get that. I prefer working on my alone, by myself in those scenarios as well, so I don't get distracted by weirdness.
Well, it's not even that. It just feels like it's a different part of my brain that I'm using, and I kind of gotta hit the clutch and slam into that other different gear, and then I can think about that, and it's really tough to do both at the same time. And flipping back and forth, I lose a lot of torque, so to speak.
Yeah, I get that. I thought nerds were the new cool kids. And aren't most writers nerds? Isn't that a thing? Because I've met quite a few writers, and almost all of them are nerds. They're not necessarily geeks, but they are all nerds.
Boop, boop, boop. So what have you done in this story that like gives it flavor? What is the, where's the crunch in this thing? You've written anything? Because I haven't been reading it in detail. But
well,
I,
that's true. So
it's really hard to read because of the angle it's at.
Yeah, I know. But I can't really, like, I'd have to like strap the camera to my body.
Yeah, that would be really tough.
I don't know if I'm at that point yet. Yeah, I have that conversation all the time. Usually people are pretty supportive, but yeah.
Well,
in that sort of like, oh, that's cool, man. You should do that. And I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna do it. Thanks.
Yeah, it feels like they asked a question and they were in no way prepared for the answer. Like they didn't even really know what they were asking.
Yeah.
Or I think the expectation with a lot of these people is more like, oh, I'm gonna make my business and, you know, do this and that, and like more concrete things is the expectation.
Yeah.
Whereas I know for me it's more nebulous than that. It's like, well, I wanna do art, man.
Do you remember, and I apologize to chat because you have no idea who I'm talking about, but do you remember Jason Blulow? Sam?
I mean, maybe? You know how bad I am with names.
He used to work in Delhi. And he used to sketch on his breaks all the time. He's a little bit older. He's probably about, probably late 30s now.
Oh, was he the one he had, like, the Matt Good quote on his arm?
I think so. He had kind of, like, that Matt Good, like, goatee... Like,
I think I know who you're talking about.
Yeah. Anyway, he's a professional artist. Like that's what he does now. And that's super inspiring. Well, I mean, that's super inspiring to me, in a weird way, because I don't think his art was great. Well, I don't.
No, I laugh because, like, you can think that, but if he's a professional artist, like, he's getting paid for that.
Yeah, well,
who are we to judge?
Well, that's the thing is, like, I don't particularly love his.
And if that's what he likes.
I don't particularly love his style, but I don't think it's necessarily not art. And I think I see things from him every now and again, because I have him on Facebook. I see things from every now and again about shows he's having, and the shows that he's at are super cool. Like, they're with a lot of other indie artists, and they're all really, really cool and academic and awesome and weird in that way. But yeah, I respect the hell out of him, and in a lot of ways, he's kind of my inspiration, because he escaped, I guess, and did something that mattered, yeah. Especially later on in life, because he was much older than I am now, when he chose to make that decision.
Well, and that casual throwaway thing that you just said, he's doing something that mattered, is something that I have a hard time getting across to people.
Yeah.
When I say, well, I want to get a real job, I want to write, and they're like, what, you're doing a real job? But I don't feel like I do anything.
Yeah. It's something I've been coming to terms with a lot lately. With that, like, working a job to pay the bills so that you can write. But sometimes that's not enough. Sometimes you gotta take some chances and, you know, push for something more creative. Something that maybe isn't necessarily a great job either, but allows you to work on the things that you can do in your spare time so you can become better. I hang out with a lot of artists, right? Like visual artists, and we're talking a lot of, like, working a graphic design job where, you know, you can flex the right muscles, but it's not necessarily, like, creative illustration and stuff like that. I agree with you entirely, Logan. What kind of stuff do you write? I write a lot of things. I write movies and books and stuff.
Yeah, that's the second most difficult question, I think, after what's your story about. You don't know. It's so hard to answer that.
Yeah, people don't get it. Don't get in the way. Hey, baby girl, what's up? Not specifically about you, actually, Johnny, but you are an example of that, yes. I was thinking of Stevie and a few other things. Yeah, what's it about? the guys at work are hilarious because they always ask me about the novel I'm working on. And I haven't worked on that novel in over a year. It's like, oh, it's going fine, I guess. Working on some short stories right now. They mean well. They mean well. I'm actually happy that they remember that much, to be honest. It's kind of a nice thing. Even if it's not as nice as I would like it.
Well, the real key is just when you do eventually get published, you just leave a copy of it sitting in the break room table and never say a goddamn word. See if anyone notices.
Oh, man. I'm not going to lie. I really want to do a book signing.
You mean at work?
Yeah. Like one of those actual, like, press tour book signings that they do all the time?
Yeah.
Like come back and be like, hey, I'm a big shot, like...
Yeah, that would be very satisfying, I admit.
Yeah. Jason has told me that he wants me to do that, so... I'm like, sure, no problem.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I'm weird and unrealistic in as much as I think my ultimate dream would be able to, like, give my writing away. I think that's so much better, like, to just be able to... But, I mean, it's totally unrealistic because you need to get paid for something.
Yeah. I agree with you. It's a hard thing. I think the world in which we live in now, for artists especially, is a world where giving away art is kind of a thing. And the people who...
It's much more doable.
Yeah, the people who want to give back to you will. That being said, it's hard work, and it involves building a community and building a following and various other things. But I think it's doable.
Well, there's so many more opportunities and such a lower barrier for entry, given things as simple as Amazon self-publishing, where you can just copy and paste whatever .txt file you want into there and set your price.
Yeah.
And but then all the way up to Kickstarter or Indiegogo or any of those things, where if you have an existing following, you can leverage that to.
Well, I was thinking something. Patreon, to a certain extent.
Or Patreon, yeah. Yeah. Patreon's a little different in that it's much less about creating a specific project and more about allowing you to start new projects, just in kind of be a bit more freeform.
That's really funny, Dry. I know exactly what that, how that goes.
Yeah.
We're all doing great here, baby girl. Yeah, Patreon is kind of like the new, well, I mean, literally in the name, it's the new patrons, right?
Yeah.
Of the Renaissance.
I think it's amazing that, you know, if you make something good and even if you've been giving it away for ages, there's a ton of people out there who desperately want to give you their money. They think it's so good.
Are you talking about the Martian again?
I know. Well, actually, I was thinking, well, that is certainly one example, although he didn't, Andy Weir didn't use Patreon, but I was thinking of things like the webcomics that I read all the time.
Yeah.
You know, those are put up whether you pay for them or not. But if you like it and you want to support that artist, and you want to see more of it, give them a couple bucks a month. It's not much out of your pocket,
well,
most of the time.
Here's a more interesting example, but certainly on point and maybe a little ironic, Twitch.
Yep. Yeah. Following or subscribing to someone.
Yeah.
Giving them a couple bucks a month.
Yeah. For sure.
I know at least one streamer that I follow who makes enough money from subscriptions and from Patreon that they quit their job and they just stream full time now.
Yep. Well, I was gonna say Stevie. Stevie used to work a UI design job. And now streams full time.
It's a brave new world we live in.
Yep.
Exciting time to be alive.
Oh yeah, for sure. Freelancing is such a thing now, and I know that's both a good and a bad thing, but in a lot of ways, I'm not going to be a partner of Twitch, I don't think. As much as I would love to use Twitch to support my writing, and that would be pretty awesome, I don't have the time right now in order to really put effort into doing that. Maybe in the future that would be a thing that I would do. But right now I'm cool with just doing Twitch for fun. Doing Twitch to have conversations about art. Learn stuff. Learn about other people. And hopefully impart something along the way. So yeah, that's why I'm on Twitch. Yeah. I don't think I'm going to be a partner. I only stream like once or twice a week, because that's all the time I have around my full-time job. I would like to change that. This week has been very eye-opening for me. Man, Sam, I've had a hell of a week. It's been awesome.
Well, I've just been jealously watching your stream notifications.
Yeah.
When I get them at work, and it's like, well, I guess I'm here.
Yeah.
Doing this thing.
That sucks, man. But
it's not good.
No. But yeah, like I'm more sure than I ever was that this is what I want to do. That I want to share my writing with the world. And I want to do this like full time. Not necessarily Twitch specifically. Well, I didn't mean Twitch. I meant if I could stream for a couple hours a day, that'd be awesome. And I could work on freelance stuff all along the side, kind of like Derek does. I'm trying to make that transition. I don't know if I've discussed this very much. I think I've mentioned it to you, Sam, but I'm actively looking for freelance jobs right now because I want to do more of this.
And I want to turn down that WWE writing job.
Oh man, I was. Yeah, I'm. That was such a cool job, but at the same time, I don't know, man. I don't know if I can handle it. I said it to you, but yeah, there's a reporting job for WWE freelance that looked awesome and seemed like it would pay fairly well, like all right, and I would watch a lot of wrestling and do stuff. It was pretty neat. it was a reporting job though, but yeah. I don't know, like, I didn't know if I could handle it. I really, when I was talking to Sam about it, and Terry and all them, if I could do, like, special features, like, if I could write about wrestlers in media, and, like, wrestling video games, and kind of branch out from just, like, watching SmackDown and giving write-ups, I would totally be in. I would love to analyze plot lines, and talk about face heel turns, and, like, all that kind of stuff. I would love to do that, but that wasn't the type of writer they wanted. And I didn't know if I could stomach watching that much SmackDown. Because as much as I like wrestling, I don't know if I like wrestling that much.
I feel like there's a like fear and loathing in wrestling opportunity there. Like, because there's so many layers to the distortion of reality that goes on. What parts of the story are real, what feuds are actually between people, and what has been scripted and what's being out just for drama. It would be fantastic to get inside there and see some of the reality and try and draw a narrative out of that and move between that real and fictitious and all the liminal places in between.
Did I ever tell you about that awesome wrestling webcomic I read once?
Probably.
I'll have to look it up, and if I do, I'll send it to you. But it was super sweet because it took this stance of like, what if wrestling was real, but not like a like everything is super serious and drama, but like off mat drama led to on mat drama, and on mat drama led to off mat drama, and it was super interesting, like the way that it played with that narrative of like what's real and what isn't, because at times it was like, oh yeah, no, this is just a play. Like our stable is this and we're doing like this thing, but other times it was like, why are you my friend? You're my friend, why are you betraying me? And it was super good. It was really legit.
Yeah, writing is a lot of work at this point.
Yeah,
but I don't know, maybe writing is like having a child. You know, it's real fun up front doing the writing part, the creating part, and then actually trying to hold that into something that's a useful part of society or a well-rounded individual is really tough and takes a lot more time.
Yep. Especially when you have all these rebellious artists who don't want to be a useful part of society.
Yeah, all those damn characters who just want to go and do their own thing. You gotta be like, no, character, you gotta get a job, you gotta get a degree, you gotta kill the siren, what the hell?
Yeah.
I hired you to kill the siren, and now all you want to do is be buddies with it? What is this?
Yep. That's pretty much how it goes.
Siren, why didn't you go to class? You just went and you sang at Greek people for a year. What is this?
Yeah, basically. Actually, I was playing around with that myth, where in my context of this story, the gods trap them at sea as punishment, and eventually, when the gods found that they actually loved the sea, they trapped them back on land, and it killed them.
I feel like there's a Promethean similarity here. Like, they've been bound to this place and left to be eternally tortured.
Yeah. I mean, basically, that's kind of what it is, and that's why the song is so sad. Because in a lot of ways, they're wrongfully punished.
Yeah, I think that's the best way to build an antagonist, if that's... And that's not really who this character is, but I always love an antagonist who isn't some, like, mustache-twirling evil villain.
Yeah. You know,
they, from their perspective, everything they're doing is legitimate, and even maybe from your perspective, what they're doing is legitimate. It just is totally counter to your interests.
Yeah.
I think that intersection of character motivations really create a compelling story, or a compelling conflict, anyway.
Yep.
From which you can create a story. The other great thing about that is, at least the way that I write, is that I will, once I kind of resolve a conflict, I always want to say, okay, what other thing can I throw down this character's path and see whether they go right or left? And when you have two very different characters like this, you can see one zig and the other zag, and you know why. Or that can inform their characters and can be informed by their character.
Yeah, because in both these cases, we have two very different characters who have basically feel like they were turned into monsters as a punishment, almost. Like they didn't have a choice in being a monster. So Hypernor is kind of like always rebelling, like conflicted with that, where he doesn't want to be a monster, but the Siren accepts it because she accepts her punishment. Because as much as it might be unjust, she still failed her mistress. So, you know, she kind of feels like she deserves it in a way.
Interesting.
Which is why I cut all those external scenes, because I kind of had that like epic story, like movie style story going along, where like, you know, he fights her and then gets convinced otherwise, and then they end up getting captured by the bad guy, the actual bad guys, and like there's a demon summoning ritual and blah blah blah. It's like, no, that's not interesting. Like that's run of the mill fantasy movie. What I want is, I want to know, like, this conversation and how it changes them. That's what matters. That's what's interesting. And how they deal with being a monster, yeah, and like, and all those like intricacies, and how she convinces him to kind of change.
It'd be very interesting to pick that story up, you know, the epic movie story just after the final battle.
Yeah, I think of that all the time, where I would love to write there's a lot of movies I would like to write a sequel to. And not necessarily like a specific, like, I want to write a sequel to this movie, but like a spiritual sequel of like taking the end of that movie as a premise for another movie.
I mean more like, you know, the two gods fight and they manage to reach a standstill, and like where maybe that would be the end of the narrative in a movie, or like where one would come up on top. Like explore how they have to deal with, like, how does this personally impact them? Like, you know, they're both sitting on rocks on opposite sides of the battlefield, sweating and bloody, and like, how do they want to deal with that? Like, because I know a lot of times when you have that kind of rivalry, you almost come to respect your enemy as much or more as your allies.
Yep.
So to see that kind of camaraderie of battle and of experience was really an interesting thing to explore.
I mean, that's kind of what made that's kind of what made Letters of Iwo Jima such a compelling film.
I don't think I could watch that.
Really? You should. You should. If you're gonna watch it, though, you should watch it with Flags of Our Fathers. They were made by Clint Eastwood around the same time, and they're better together than they are apart. Because they show the two different sides. There's like one from the American side and one from the Japanese side. But yeah, Letters from Iwo Jima stars, what's his face there? That guy who's in everything.
Ken Watanabe.
Yeah, Ken Watanabe. He's amazing.
Yeah, that guy's he's in a shitload of stuff.
He's in everything. He's like, if you need a Japanese actor, he's in it.
Yep. Yeah, he is the Hollywood, like, archetype for a Japanese actor.
It's him and the guy from 47 Ronin.
He was in 47 Ronin, wasn't he?
Ken Watanabe? I don't know. I don't think he was. He was in The Last Samurai.
Why not?
Is that what you're thinking of?
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of. Yeah, the other guy, whose name I'm going to butcher, Hiroyuki Sanada. Maybe that's... No, he was... Yeah, he was in 47 Ronin.
Yeah, I think...
He, I remember from Sunshine, as Kanada, the captain of the ship.
Right. I think that's the guy I'm thinking of. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, that guy. That guy's the other, like, big Hollywood Japanese actor.
He is also very good.
Yes. Yes, he is. Sunshine was a great film.
I actually, as much as people complain about it having that weird turn at the end, I friggin' love that. That's kind of my favorite part, where it's like all this build up, all this tension, and then you have this insane release, just like this whip crack of madness at the end. And you never quite see the evil guy, because he's always silhouetted against the sun. So the sun is almost more the enemy than anything else.
Well, I think that's kind of the point of that like movie, right? Like, the sun kind of is the enemy.
Well, the sun is this adversarial thing that they've got to wrestle with. Whether or not it's actively an antagonist is a different question.
Fair enough. It is trying to kill them.
What did you see, Kanada?
Sanada was in The Last Samurai as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, Google's doing some spooky stuff right now where it's like, oh, you searched for multiple actors. You're looking for the people from this movie.
Fair enough.
Like, it's totally separately from the result. It's like, hey, these last three people you searched were all in this film. This is what you're looking for, isn't it?
I love Google. So good at what it does.
Beautiful, beautiful AI.
The one that's doing... the kind of the Hollywood Asian actor of today is Lee Byung-hee, who's a Korean actor who's been in, like, everything. Like, he was in Red and Red 2. He was in all the G.I. Joe films, the new ones. He's been in a bunch of stuff. Oh, sorry, not Lee Byung-hee. Lee Byung-hun. Sorry. He was the Terminator in Genesis.
Jeez, I didn't even watch that movie. The last canon Terminator is the second one, as far as I'm concerned.
That's fair. Anyway, he's the Hollywood Asian guy right now. He's been in a ton of stuff. He's gonna be in the new Magnificent Seven remake, which looks so good. Well, I haven't seen any trailers, but the cast looks amazing.
Yeah, let's hope it's good. Man, they could fuck that up.
Yeah. But did you see the cast for it, Sam?
No.
It's Denzel Washington, Chris Pratt, Ethan Hawke, Vincent D'Onofrio, Lee Byung-hun, I don't know the other two guys, Peter Sarsgaard, Haley Bennett, Vinny Jones. Like, that is a cast. That is a cast.
This is quite a cast. That's like Tarantino territory of the number of big actors.
Yep.
Yeah, Jesus. There's like no one in this who isn't huge.
Oh yeah, Matt Bomer, I know him. Luke Grimes, I think I know him. Oh yeah. This guy's awesome. Yeah, anyway.
It's terrific and tragic Tarantino territory.
Just such a great cast. I love Akira Kurosawa. I love The Seven Samurai. I love the adaptations of The Seven Samurai. There's a really cool one with a bunch of mech samurai in a cyberpunk Japan.
Yes, please.
Yeah, it's called Samurai 7. It's amazing. Actually, Netflix recommended the newest Netflix anime. Netflix original anime is a samurai Gundam story at a high school research facility, and I was like, so I'm watching this next week, right? Like, that's happening.
Sorry, I'm still looking for this Samurai 7. Here we go.
It's got a guy who wears pot-belly stove, basically, on him.
Oh my god, some of the images for this. This is great.
Yeah.
This is the good shit.
It's really cool. I really like that one. But yeah, Akira Kurosawa in general is awesome. Throne of Blood is a masterpiece. That's all I have to say.
Blood for the blood god. Skulls for the skull throne.
Well, Throne of Blood is a Shogun era retelling of Macbeth by Akira Kurosawa in black and white, starring Toshiro Mifune, the samurai actor himself.
That would be pretty great.
It was amazing.
I think that would translate pretty perfectly.
It was like word for word. It's basically Macbeth takes over the shogunate instead of being king. It's
the political situation is actually so similar.
Yep. And all this weirdness about Ronin and it's just the way he does it. It's so good. And Toshiro Mifune, for all of his reputation as like a samurai actor, is an amazing samurai actor. Like, he is a very good actor who only plays samurai.
You know, they typecast him as a samurai, but he totally plays an amazing samurai.
He does. He's a really good samurai. So yeah, the original Magnificent Seven, starring Yul Brynner, was a remake of it. And
yeah, it's the retelling of that same myth or
yeah, because
epic story, I guess.
Well, I was gonna say because feudal Japan has a lot of similarities to the Wild West. There's been a lot of academic articles written on the similarities between the two. I mean, a samurai is basically the same as a lone gunman in the Wild West, right? Like, there's so many parallels.
There's some substantial differences, but yeah, there's a lot of similarities.
Historically there are a lot of differences, but it has that sort of isolation and kind of the other, right? Of being that one man against the world sort of thing.
Yeah, and I think the biggest thing that stands out for me is the Bushido code that goes along with being a samurai, even if you're a Ronin. Whereas if you're a Wild West lone gunman, you're just trying to get away most of the time, and you don't care about the rules. And in a lot of cases, it's because you don't care about the rules.
Right, but I was thinking of like the man with no name who kind of has his own honor code.
That particular archetype, the man in black, the man with no name.
Yeah. You're right. Like, if you're talking like a rogue bandit gunman, yes. Yeah. Toshirô Mifune has been in 170 feature films.
That's a lot of movies.
He's done 16 with Akira Kurosawa.
Damn.
Yeah. But yeah, he's played a samurai a lot.
Well, I'd hope he's good after that much samuraiing. Like, you know, you'd be good at anything if you do it that much. That's your 10,000 hours of being a samurai.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they're talking about it here in the Wikipedia article on him. Clint Eastwood was among the first of many actors to adopt this wandering warrior persona for foreign films, which he used to great effect in his Western roles, especially The Man with No Name, where he plays a similar character to Mifune's Ronin with No Name role in Yojimbo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even his Dirty Harry movies are kind of similar. That character is kind of similar.
Yeah. For sure. There's definitely a lot of parallels to that. I've seen two of the five Dirty Harrys.
I think I've seen all of them. Maybe only four of them.
I only really like the first one. I don't know. Maybe the third or fourth would be better.
You mean, like, actually Dirty Harry?
Yeah, actually Dirty Harry.
That's not the first one.
Is it not?
Is that the first one?
I'm pretty sure that's the first one.
Wikipedia, tell me your secrets. Yes, it was. Yeah. It's weird because I think I'm most familiar with the Deadpool, the last one.
Okay.
And I think it's probably just because it is the most recent. So it was slightly more contemporary when I saw it.
Yeah. I didn't like the second one. I watched the second one. I thought it was mediocre. It didn't have...
Mediocre.
Well, it had that element of Dirty Harry being Dirty Harry, but it didn't have the weirdness and strangeness of the antagonist that the first one had.
Yeah. Dirty Harry had a really interesting and personal relationship between the detective and the criminal, which is something that it was very much trying to explore, and that's something that I think is really interesting.
Yeah.
And it kind of got lost under the action movie that they turned into.
Yeah, I think so.
So many good quotes that came out of those Dirty Harry movies. It's so memorable.
Yeah.
And so many things that are misquoted.
Yep. I mean, do you feel lucky, punk, being misquoted?
Yeah, never said that.
Nope.
He never said that. At all.
He called the guy a punk a lot. And he did say...
Well, after talking about, like, do you know whether I shot five... times or six, he says, you gotta ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky?
Yeah.
Well, do you, punk? And then
they kind of got shortened.
Well,
he
pulls
way.
The trigger.
Yep.
Well, he that character had such a...
That was such a throwaway moment, too. Like, they...
Yeah, it's not even part of the main plot.
Well, I guess it's not throwaway. It really establishes who the character is and what they're about. So it's actually really effective. It's just... It's such a weird moment of, like, at the beginning of the film, he, like, arrests this bank robber because he happens to be in the area. And, like, this whole thing plays out, and that's, like, the thing that people remember is that moment.
Yeah, well, exactly, and it informs who Dirty Harry is really all the way through those movies.
Yeah, totally.
He's the guy who's willing to take that risk, like, yeah, maybe I'll blow your head off, maybe I won't. Worst scenario, I don't blow your head off.
Yeah.
And of course,
he establishes himself as a risk taker. Night, Johnny.
Yes.
I'll talk Good to you night. Later. Yeah, he establishes himself as a risk taker, which plays throughout that movie. Throughout the entire series, really. Where, you know, he's not afraid to go against the grain if it's kind of the right thing to do.
Yeah, he'll totally use the law as long as it's useful for him, but as soon as it gets in his way, he just discards it.
Yeah.
Sentence. I don't like that sentence. He fought for money, and once he accepted a contract, he finished it. That's so clunky.
Yeah, I agree. His perspective doesn't really come out in it either. And I think this is super out of character as well.
Yeah, you need more of like a his word is his bond kind of thing there, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
So, I mean, I don't feel like these people would have spoken in terms of contracts. I mean, at least not in a mythological sense. It was more of a point of honor.
Yeah, I mean, mercenaries were totally a thing, right? Like,
yes, but
it wouldn't be contracts. So
it would be, but they wouldn't think of it as. It wasn't the contract that was the important thing, I guess.
Yeah, I agree. And I think this is out of character. Ourselves.
Yeah, it's too. You're looking at it from a too modern perspective.
I found that a lot of the dialogue has been very modern in this, and I tried to change it. There was one line that I thought was like straight from a Sword and Sandals movie, and I was like, "Yes, this is the best line ever."
I shall smite thee.
Where'd it go? I just smell vanilla coming off these.
Your highlighters smell like vanilla?
No, the protein shake I spilled on them does.
Oh.
I'm Hyperinor of the Spartai. You've come to hire my sword, have you not?
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's good, I'm just saying it sounds very sword and sandally.
Yeah, it sounds like something from a trailer that you'd see, and then they'd cut away to him like swinging a sword or something.
Yeah. Cut this. I like this description, but I think it needs to go in a different place. So it feels like he embraces his destiny a little bit too much for the kind of like hate he has for his own monstrosity.
Yeah, you really need to leverage that, I think, a lot more.
Yeah.
That mental dissonance that he's got between hating what he is and using it to his advantage.
Yeah. I agree. You agree entirely.
Like, again, I said it before, the Jerry of Rivia, the way he...
It's Rivertown.
Jerry of Rivertown, the way he frequently will play up the fact that he is a witcher and that he knows people are kind of afraid of that. So he can intimidate people or push them in directions because he knows their preconceptions.
He's almost as dangerous as the monsters.
From their perspective, yes.
Yeah. Well, I mean, but from our perspective, too, but yes.
Maybe, but he's not here to, you know, just murder a bunch of dudes. He doesn't kill people unless you pay him.
Yeah. Or they, like, disrupt...
Oh, they fuck with
him. Yeah, they disrupt him in some way in which he feels like vengeance is a proper course of action.
But even that has to be something pretty substantial.
Right.
Like, there's plenty of instances where he just shrugs things off like, wow, you are just some hater.
Yeah, oh yeah, totally. I'd be interested to know, and I suspect that this is the case, but I'd be interested to know if that perspective is heavily communicated in the book series. I assume it would be.
Yeah, but... and I've been looking for a good English version. I know some people, some other streamers that I've talked to who really like the books and who've read the books, and they said, in fact, it was actually this Finnish streamer who, like, I asked him, like, do you read it? What, is there a good translation? He's like, yeah, I read it in English, because the Finnish one is garbage, apparently. The best translations are actually the English ones.
That would make sense, because of the heavy English following, because of the games and stuff.
I think it was even before the games came out. There's just such a large English language market for books.
Well, I was going to say, I think it's hard to say because I don't know the book market well enough in other translated areas, but I feel like the English translation scene, a good translator is like a high commodity, right? And there's a lot to be said about good translators, and they get a lot of work. And I'm thinking of even, I can't remember his name, but that guy who won the Nebula for his translation of, I think, the Three Body Problem. Was that not it?
Yes, I'm pretty sure it was that guy.
Yeah, like he won a Nebula for his translation.
His translation is extremely good in that. And being
right?
Partway, two-thirds of the way through the second one, which is translated by someone else, it's not as good. And it's actually a little disorienting when you can see... something that was obviously the same word in Chinese that's now a different third word than what it was translated to in the first book.
Yeah, like, totally.
There's one term they call it a flying star in the original or in the first book, and then they call it a shooting star or something. It's something slightly different, and it's hard to make that connection.
Yep. I mean, I see that all the time in the Scanlation community. Where, you know, you'll have one guy who's pretty decent and has a good proofreader and does a good job. And then, like, that translator will have real life stuff, so he doesn't work on the next couple. So somebody else comes in and they're much, much worse. Or they translate things differently and it's confusing. Like character names or different things, you know?
Yeah, especially if you're translating from something that doesn't use the same alphabet, man, spelling gets crazy weird and bad.
Yeah, and names, and like the thing about names are so important in Japanese literature. Like what a name means and what it stands for and how it's written matter. Because there's lots of like weird like. Translate like weird mispronunciation jokes where someone will read a name wrong because that's what the characters could be read at, and it's like a joke, right? Like,
yeah.
we don't have that
it's
in English
like
in the same way.
Well, you could totally spin it as like, you know, putting a different emphasis on the words in English where you can produce a very different sound,
right? But how do you communicate that really effectively in writing?
It's not easy.
No. It's something like my favorite example is there's a Key and Peele sketch about a supply teacher who the supply teacher is from the ghetto and he goes to like a prep school, so he pronounces everybody's name like they're from the ghetto.
Yes, I've seen that and
it's
amazing.
It's
and
hilarious.
All students have like no idea what's going on.
Yeah. But that's kinda what that is, right? Like It's that weird, like, interpretation.
Well, it's a... That was actually a beautiful exploration of regional accents.
Yeah.
Like, he's not wrong, you know? If you were in a different place, that is totally how those words would be pronounced.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's something that you can really only communicate well with sound, I think. Be hard to write that differently.
With the Latin alphabet? Probably. Yeah, it doesn't lend itself to that.
I love this line, but I don't know where I should put it.
Oh, typo.
Where?
Persephone was out mistress.
Yeah.
Yeah, speaking of translations, actually, I just was watching, I think, well, it's the third to last episode of a Let's Play that I, Chip Cheezum Let's Play. You know I love Chip Cheezum.
I know you love Chip Cheezum.
And it was Zone of the Enders, which is a Hideo Kojima game that he made long in the, like, mid-90s. And that game tanked because they ran out of money. Or they just chose not to spend the money on a proper translation. So they got someone to translate it extremely literally.
Right.
And there are huge segments that make absolutely no sense. You can tell what they're sort of going for. But, like, at one point, someone says, the main character Dingo says, he quotes someone, and the other person says, "Who's second hand?" And it just makes no goddamn sense. It's like they're clearly trying to say, who are you quoting? You know, who's that second hand from? But they chose to just translate the words literally instead of localizing it properly.
Yeah. Yeah, translating is an art. I don't know if I told you this, but I did some work in the Scandinavian community for a while when I was trying to work on my skills, like doing proofreading. And I actually did some translating from French. And doing translating from French wasn't a huge deal for me, because I graduated immersion and all that. So I used Google Translate, and then I edited it based on how I interpreted the words and stuff like that. And it came across fairly well. But I was proofreading the hardest manga to proofread ever. It was a manga called Mao Mao Yusha, and there's a bunch of different variants of it. But basically, the entire point of the manga, which I love the idea of, was everyone was named after what they were. So, like, the hero was literally named Hero in Japanese. And the Demon Queen is literally Demon Queen. And there was a young merchant and an old merchant. And they were named that. And it got really, really weird because I couldn't deal with the way that the language was. Like, it was like this weird, like, political economic drama of, like, fantasy, epic fantasy stuff. And it was so hard to deal with. Because it dealt with all these really, really tough concepts that the translator couldn't necessarily explain to me. Because they weren't, like, readily available to me. It sucked.
Yeah.
It sucked bad.
It's hard to translate. It's almost possible to translate allusions to things that you don't know what they are.
Yeah. Well, and that was just a very high-handed, like, high-concept book. And, like, I feel like any translation of it was going to be bad, no matter who translated it. Because there's so many things that you're trying to communicate in every single bubble. And it was all dialogue. Like, there wasn't any action scenes. It was, like, all dialogue. People talking about economics and people talking about plans and stuff. Like, it was crazy. I think they dropped it not long after I left because, like, it was too hard. Which sucked because the parts that were done, like, were really good. Like, it seemed like a really awesome manga. But it was just, unless you're getting paid to do it, why would you do something like that? Like, beats me, man.
Yeah, there was There's one of those in the Dark Forest where there was this line, someone said, this is like when that deity, and I can't remember what the name was, separated the earth from the heavens, and I'm like, I have no context for this. I don't know what myth this is. I don't recognize that deity name, but like, it's very clearly a creation myth. But like, I can't appreciate the significance of this guy who's clearly really shocked.
Yeah, that's when I knew I had made it. When I was watching dramas and I got their references to other dramas, it was like, okay, I'm good now. I've watched enough.
Yeah, no, you actually
understand. I'm part of this world.
Well, that I think is a sign of good world building when you can integrate that into the world, where you can make reference to things without having to explicitly explain them.
Yeah. Oh yeah, totally. I was talking about Borges yesterday. I read some out loud, and I love the way that he does that, where everything is a reference. Like it's like a cryptic literary shorthand of metaphor and...
Yeah, that's an impressive thing to be able to pull off.
Yeah. He's an impressive writer, and I'm reading a translation from Spanish, because he's an Argentinian writer. But yeah, I was gonna say most of the translations were published while he was still alive, so I believe most of them, like almost all of them, were done with him there, sort of thing, like translating with him. Which, if you can do that's the best way.
Definitely, because then at least you can get. You can be informed of the intent of the original writer, so you don't mistranslate.
Yeah.
Or misconstrue things.
Especially something as academic as that, where, like, the language matters. The choices matter. Hello, FF42. I'm working on a short story I started on stream approximately 8 weeks ago. I only work on it on stream, though. I don't work on it off stream, so... My timing on this is actually really good. I think it comes down to, what was it? I calculated it out. I think it's like 40 hours maybe I've worked on this total. Which is pretty good. It's actually about a siren. Okay, so it's about a mythical Greek hero or mercenary who has been hired to kill a siren, and it's about exploring what it means to be a monster, because they're both mythical monster types. There was a whole thing about a demon summoning ritual and a bunch of stuff like that, but I actually ended up cutting that for the most part. It still informs the story, but it's mostly gone. Because I realized that the conversation about monsters and their conversations with each other mattered a lot more. So it got a little bit shorter, but it's more effective. It is 9:55, Sam.
It is. Yeah, how long are you going to go? Are you ending at 10?
I think so. I've pretty much only been doing 3-hour episodes. I kind of like that time. 3 hours. I think more than that is a little much.
Yeah, for a single sitting or if someone's watching the VOD, that gets pretty long.
Yeah. So yeah, for those of you just tuning in, this is my good friend and moderator, MC Pepper Pockets, also known as Sam. He was joining me to kind of be a audio distraction from me sitting staring at words for 3 hours. And also kind of just disperse some conversations about writing and what we both think and the way we interact with it. And also about movies and games and random stuff.
All the different kinds of storytelling.
Yep. So yeah, I'm gonna finish this page real quick, like get it done in the last 5 minutes. I only have 2 paragraphs left. I think that's okay.
I don't know. I think you need to pare down those questions.
The question, yes. I meant the line about I thought this one was okay, but I could be wrong.
Oh. Yeah.
I think that's okay. It might need a little bit of a rewrite, but...
How much is this ancient Grecian character speculating about placebo effect?
I don't know. Not a ton. But then I kind of repeat the kind of same thing here, so repetition.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure this is already implied, so I don't need it. Yeah. I need to work a little bit on how I want to tell the myth of the sirens, or the Ovid version of the myth. Specifically...
You mean you're just gonna...
Sorry.
You're gonna readapt it?
Well, I already did. But I just like, what details am I missing? What details are important? Is there a better way to tell this story? Like... Right now it says, one morning when we woke, she was gone. It's like, is there something else there that can make it more interesting? Like, what details do I know that might be missing? Or might be relevant to the telling of the tale? But yeah. All right. So... I finished that page. Excellent. That's page 11 of 18 that I finished. Editing takes a long time. Especially when you're talking about other things, but I feel like just me like staring at the page is not as interesting.
I think this has made it all go a little quicker.
Yeah.
Feeling.
Yeah. I think so too. So yeah, gonna close it out for tonight. I will go to the big camera. Here we are. Wow, I look really sweaty. It's hot in here. Lights, man. So yeah. My name is Brendan. This is Accidental Origin, the weekly writing web show. The last week, this is the 8th day in a row I've streamed. I did a whole drafting week where I drafted the first draft of that story. And can I say draft any more times in one sentence? I think not. Yeah, I had a great week. I wrote like 3,500 words. I edited most of it. I think the story is really good. I think it's got quite a bit of potential. There's work left to be done, and I'm going to keep working on it on stream over the next couple of weeks to finish it off. hopefully. But I will keep you informed of my plans for that, for sure. Anyway, a big thank you to Sam for joining me and all of you for hanging out. But that's it for tonight. So, bye. Say your goodbye,
bye.
Sam. All right. And just before I go, if you want to check out my website, I have all the VODs and documents, show notes, drafts and all that on there, as well as check me out on Twitter, and feel free to send me a message about what you think or if you have any questions or anything like that. So yeah, take care all. Bye-bye.